Good morning. Hey, let's stand up. Let's pray. If you're online at home, let's stand up and pray with us. Lord, I just thank you for today. Thank you that we're making a choice to spend time in your presence. Pray that it would be a fruitful time, an encouraging time, a time where there would be a divine interaction. Thank you for everything that's going on here at Hope. And may you be honored and glorified today. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing, but failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. Oh. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into
I ran out of that grave. Great the chasm in between us. How high the mountain we climb. In desperation, I turn to heaven. Spoke your name into the night.
Through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. I could imagine so great a mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame.
The cross has spoken,
I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah,
praise the one who set me free.
Out of the silence, the roaring lion.
It is Jesus who is our living hope. He's the only one that could break the bondage of death. He's the only one that owns death because he rose again. And I am so thankful to him today for what he's done in our lives, my life. So let's take this time and this next song and behold him and just worship him and just sing to Jesus for what he has done, how he has freed us, how has he delivered us, and how he's teaching us to live life abundantly.
He who heard humanity's cry. clap. So it was awesome just hearing you all sing this morning in the midst of life's chaos, that this is a space where we can meet with God and that he is unchanging. He's the same today that he was yesterday, and he's worthy of our trust. Amen. All right, we'll take a quick second. Say hi to the people around you. All right. Well, good morning, everyone. Oh, I think I only got one good morning. Good morning. There we go. Nice to see you. Glad you guys are all here. If you join us online, glad you join us online. Maybe you're inside out of the smoke because it's pretty smoky out there today. So glad you're here. It's a fun season. It's like mid-camp season. So we've had kids coming and kids going. Got middle school camp starting this week and high school camp. It's just a fun time here at Hope. As an ex-youth pastor, it's my favorite season. So if you guys are new, you're jumping in a fun week. If you haven't met me before, my name is Nathan Hartley. I'm one of the pastors here. Glad you're spending your Sunday with us. If you're new, newish, best way to connect with us, there's connect cards. That's the blue card that's right in front of you there to the left or right a little bit. You can fill that out, bring it by the hello table. I'll be out there after service. Love to meet you. Introduce myself, answering questions you have, any of that type of stuff. That's a great way to just connect with us about anything. If you have prayer requests, anything like that, want to sign up to serve in some way, you can always write things there and we'll be in touch with you. Or if you're online or want to do a digital connect card, you can text HOPENEW with no space to 94,000. And that's a great way to connect with us too. You can always text that number in once you've subscribed to the list there. And with prayer requests, things like that, we share with the staff and we pray for you guys every week. So you can always text in your prayer requests there. And great way to connect with us. So there's a few fun things happening that I want to make sure is on your radar. One of them would be, if you're like me and you've had the supplies for our Help the City drive sitting by like your front door to take out all month for the hygiene packs, we're partnering with Good Shepherd Clothes Closet to distribute. You can bring the box of razors that you keep forgetting anytime this week. We'll finish out July with the Help the City drive. So Michael has all the supplies out there ready to be packed up and delivered, but it's not too late. If you picked something up and forgot to bring it in or haven't picked it up yet, you can drop it by this week and we'll be here all week long. So next thing is movie night. So we have our back to school movie night coming up here in a couple weeks. So a week from Friday on August 6th, Friday night, 7:30 p.m., we're going to be over at Zion Park, which is the new park that's over on Veterans. So we get to be the guinea pigs for the city and break in their new park with the first event. So I'm excited for that. It's going to be a fun time. Come out that Friday night, 7:30, brand new park. That is a fantastic event to invite neighbors, bring kids, grandkids, bring people you don't know and might be uncomfortable walking in the doors of the church. They can hang out with us at the park and realize we're not that weird. We're a little weird, but not that weird. So great event to bring people out to. I love showing up to events like this and not knowing anybody, because if you're an extrovert, that's exciting. If you're introvert, that's punishment. But for an extrovert, I'm excited to see a whole bunch of people I don't recognize there, because we want this to be a community event. So come hang out. I know Michael's going to need some help with that event. So if you want to help out with that, just make a note in your Connect card, drop it in the Joy box, and he'll be in touch with you too. Sound all right? And let's pray we don't have smoke. Otherwise, that movie on the projector is going to look very theatrical and exciting. So let's pray no smoke coming up in a week and a half. So lastly, thank you guys for being faithful with your giving, your offering. And here's Bill.
Hey. Just to finish Nathan's announcement, and we have joy boxes in the back if you want a place to put your joy, your offerings, tithes and offerings. Yeah, and I'm glad someone cheered about our offerings, so thank you. Hey, we're going to be in Matthew 25, and boy, I am glad that people are in the building. When Steph and I went downtown to eat on Friday, I thought we would hit traffic going up 580, and I was surprised we had no traffic. I thought everyone might have cleared out of town because of the fires. Now, this makes me feel at home. Guy, growing up in Southern California, I always feel more comfortable when I could see the air I breathe. And some of you guys can't relate to that, but some of us can definitely relate to that. Hey, so we got kids camp, just came back, excellent camp. Lenny's taking off this afternoon. Middle schoolers are showing up tomorrow morning. I believe middle schoolers go through the midweek sometime, and then high schoolers show up. And so let's pray that the fires get more contained and that the smoke might not be as bad on Camp Richardson on the west side of the lake or the southwest side of the lake, and that people would come to Christ. Now, I'm already praying for 100 inches of snow so we don't have to go through this next year. So you know I don't like winter that much. And so let me go ahead and pray, and we're going to jump into Matthew 25. Lord, I just thank you for the group you brought here. Thank you for the new people. Thank you for the kids going to camp. May they have a interaction with you that will change their life and put them on your path for the rest of their life. May we hear from you today. And I thank you for the group you brought here. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys probably noticed Brandon's not here. Brandon is in Kansas City somewhere visiting his folks. I thank Chuck and the team and all the people here, faithfulness to serve and lead us in worship. So thank you guys for that. Got a quick joke. Two mafia hitmen are walking in the woods at midnight, you know, deep into the woods. It's really dark. And one of the guys says, "I have to admit, I'm a little afraid." And the other guy said, "You're afraid. I have to walk out of here by myself." All right, second service. All right. Don't let first service take the award of laughing better than you guys. I used to joke with first service, and now they're showing up awake to church. And you guys had an extra hour of sleep, extra cup of coffee. Anyways, we don't need to talk about that anymore. Here we go. Little stories with big ideas. We've been in a series of parables. We're going to be doing this series, continuing this series until the end of August. September, Nathan's putting the series for the other pastors. As I'm on sabbatical, he's putting that series together. And so we are going to look at the parable of the 10 virgins. The title of the talk is Now You Know. Here you go. The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Now, let's just stop here. Now, the way they did weddings in Bible times is dramatically different than how we do weddings here. Now, they actually still, in Palestine, do weddings similar to what we see here in Matthew 25. So there is a set date, but really no set time. And the bridegroom shows up at a surprise time. Another thing different is that their wedding celebration goes on for several days, where our celebrations go on for just a couple of hours. Now, so here the bridegroom shows up at midnight. They're already asleep, and there's the surprise showing up at midnight. Now, if Rachel and Ricky's wedding was like this, I would not be happy for Ricky showing up at midnight at all. If he showed up at 5 a.m, I'm on my first cup of coffee. If he shows up at 7, I'm all right. I'm on my second cup of coffee. Not that I have an exact routine every day for 365 days. But this wedding, they could identify with because this is what took place in the Bible time when Jesus told a story. Everyone knew what was going on. So here we go. We pick it up. This is just like a wedding back in those days. I'm not sure how many people show up at midnight ready to party for several days. But at midnight, verse 6, was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said to the wives, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wives answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourself." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterwards, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered, "Truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, you know neither the day nor the hour." Matthew is a very thematic book. A couple things that you notice in Matthew you might not notice in the other Gospels. It's not the kingdom of God, it's the kingdom of heaven. And so you'll see that phrase often. Matthew's main targeted audience was to the Jews. And so the Jews were hesitant of using God's name just in case they used it in a disrespectful way. And so Matthew uses the kingdom of heaven. Here also in Matthew, we get closer to the cross, we get closer to the resurrection, we get closer to the Last Supper. And the parables near the end of the book are parables which you could say is the judgment discourse. And so the parables in near the end of Matthew are dealing with the end times, dealing with the second coming. And so this parable is also dealing with the end times and the second coming. Now, there's things definitely applicable to us. And I'm hoping that you're here just like, I want this to be a fruitful time. And I believe that God desires to speak to each and everyone in this room and to speak to those online. Here we go. The first one is this. God's resources are available for all of humanity. For all of humanity. For the whole world. For white people, for black people, for red people, for brown people, for all the whole world, for Republicans, for Democrats, for in-between people, for everybody. God's heart from the beginning of time has always been for the whole world. Now, you could look up in different Bible commentaries, and they have different takes on oil, what the oil represents. But when I look at this, stepping back a little bit, is that it's God's desire for all of us to have the resource to know him personally. Is God's resources are available for all of humanity. We see in John 3:17, "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order the world might be saved through him," the whole world. And so how do people come to Christ? Where do they find the knowledge? Where do they get the resources? It's people like you and I that pass on the resources. We are the distributors of Jesus. We are the distributors of salvation to the world. When Jesus left, his business plan for the kingdom to go forward was Peter, James, John, and you know, there's eight more men right there, along with the women that are mentioned in Acts. That was the plan. It was imperfect people like you and I, no perfect people allowed. God's resources are available for all of humanity. Now, we got Bags of Hope out there, and we've been doing it, and this year's looked dramatically different with the pandemic. But hopefully this year the schools are open in a greater way and we'll get back into the schools with Bags of Hope. And so there's black bags out there, and the black bags have food in there for us to hand out to people that are in more difficult situations than us, that people live on the streets, live in their cars. Is how do they get that? Simply, we pick up a bag, we put it in our car, we see someone, and we say, this is for you. And, you know, I do that with bottled water in the summer times. People are super hot with a soft protein bar in there. How do they get that? I got the bags behind my seat. I pull it out and say, here you go, just thinking you might use this. This is what happens. This is salvation, is God's resources are available for all of humanity, all of humanity. Matthew 7 kind of ties into this parable in this sense. Let me read the text here that Jesus is talking about, the wise builder and the unwise builder. We see the wise and the foolish in this parable. If you go back to Matthew 7, Jesus is talking about wise and foolish. Everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Now, when we look at Matthew 7, when do we discover the foundation of people's houses? Is when the storm comes. None of us know the foundation of the house, but when the storm comes, the house that stands reveals that the storm was built on God's foundation, and the house that falls reveals that the foundation was not built on God's word. Here in the parable, what do we see? Everyone looks prepared. If the bridegroom came at 7 in the morning, they didn't need more oil. But the bridegroom came at midnight, and it revealed those who were prepared and those who are not prepared. And we got some harsh or hard words that when I read this, in the sense of Christ coming back, the end times, verse 12, but he answered, truly I say to you, I do not know you. As God's resources are available for all humanity, we are the ones that distribute salvation or offer Jesus to others. That is God's plan for this world. That is God's plan for South Reno, is using Hope Community, and that's God's plan to use Hope Community throughout the whole world. We are God's resources. The second thing, being spiritually skilled is a life saver. All of us come into this room in July and second service when it's really smoky, there's less of us. But we all look prepared. But Jesus, when he comes back, if he were happened to come back at this time, he would know the ones that really know him and those that don't know him. And the ones that know him are ones that are respecters of his instruction. They knew to take steps that reflected what their belief was, that the bridegroom could come at any time, and they got extra oil. The other people were not respecters of his instruction, and they were not prepared at his coming. No one gets away with being unprepared. No one gets away with being unprepared. It is impossible for us to get away with being spiritually unprepared. Now, this week, I had just a normal pastor week, good things and challenging things. Thursday morning, I go to my friend, a dermatologist. I get 5 zaps. And 1 cut. He said, the Mo's guy has kids in college. You need to go see him. He said, you've already put my kids through college, but just to show that I like you, zap, 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 zap. And so I got zapped there. Then Friday afternoon, I go play with my favorite dog, Rogan, and he eats up my arm a little bit. And then Friday morning, I'm playing golf with my buddy who loses his ball on 18, and I'm looking for his golf ball, but I find five other golf balls, and so my legs are all scratched up. But the reason that I have to go see my dermatologist, when I grew up, there is no instructions on how to protect your skin. And so I go to Zuma Beach, lifeguard station 8 most of the time, and it would smell like coconut because it felt like if you put copper tone and you had this coconut smell, is that it had a positive action on your skin. When the reality is, or if you put baby oil, which was way worse for your skin, on, is that it's my generation that came up with the ideas that we need dermatologists and that we have skin cancer and all these things. Now the instruction, I have the knowledge. Now, every day in the summer, before I came to church, sunscreen, 50 strength goes on my arms, it goes on my face, it goes on my neck, as I'm responding to his instruction. If you're a Christ follower and you really have Christ in your heart, is that you're gonna be a respecter of his instruction. What is his instruction? Is right here, is God's word is our final instruction to us and how to live. How to be spiritually skilled, how to have a life of full of wisdom. Being spiritually skilled is a life saver. Now, let me go ahead and read some of these quotes here. J.I. Packer, not until we have become humble and teachable, standing in awe of God's holiness and sovereignty, acknowledging our littleness, distrusting our own thoughts, and willing to have our minds turned upside down, can divine wisdom become ours. My friend Cornelius says this, wisdom in Scripture is, broadly speaking, the knowledge of God's world and the knack of fitting oneself into it. Is wisdom, biblical wisdom, is a skill for living, and biblical wisdom represents what's going on in our life. In James, it says, you might have faith, I have works, but James writes down, he says, because I have faith, here are my works. True faith is reflected in our lifestyle. Being spiritually skilled is a life saver. Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fear is awe and respect. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Being spiritually skilled is a life saver. God's resources are for everybody. Being spiritually skilled is a life saver. Now, in this parable, salvation is based on what? Is being prepared. Now, you look at the whole Bible, that's how we interpret Scripture, is just not on one simple parable. His salvation is based on knowing Jesus. But the way the Bible teaches us what that looks like is we are prepared. Now, today we got this parable. Next week we got a parable that's going to tie into baptism. And the week after we have another parable that's in the judgment discourse, that the basis of salvation is a little bit different than this one, but it's all wrapped up in a relationship with Jesus. And the third and final one is Jesus will come at an unexpected time. Verse 13, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. Now, every church or Bible-believing church knows that Jesus is coming. I don't know, we don't talk about it a lot here, But there is a belief, and there is a definitely belief in my heart that there's going to be a second coming. There's going to be end of the world as we know it. Here, Jesus is letting us know there's a separation. Some go into the wedding, and some are left out of the wedding, heaven and not heaven. Jesus will come at an unexpected time. Now, have you ever noticed some Christians are weird? Is that we have, it's just like my family, I have weird family members, and there's some people in the church that just get so latched on to the second coming, is that they just appear to be a little weird. Weird people are welcome here at Hope Community. And so in May, I think the guy in May, there's this dude, and totally into the second coming, talking to me after church and asking me my stance. And, you know, we're just talking about it. And he said, my friend has been studying, and my friend believes Jesus is coming back this week. And I thought, well, I really don't want to hear this story, but okay, he's coming back this week. You know how many people have said that? You know how many people have become rich from writing books about the second coming when Jesus is coming? Jesus will come, and he will come at an unexpected time. There's a guy I follow on Facebook, Jimmy Evans. He has a wedding. He has a marriage ministry, but he wrote a book on the second coming. Now, no, I did not buy the book at all, but I read the summary of the book that was advertised on Facebook, which I totally agree with. Jesus is coming back, and if you know him, you have nothing to be afraid of. So often is that there's a fear in the end times, but if we know him, we know it's unexpected, is that he's coming back, and we have nothing to fear. There's always, like, first service is not always like second service. Like, I always leave out something, first service or second service. You don't know I leave it out, and so you really don't know. You thought you just got it all, but somehow is that in my skill is that there's little things I leave out. And so first service, I left this out. But I saw this story, and this Air Force guy, he flew 300 missions, and the first Iraq war ended. And he was coming home. He was surprised he was discharged so quickly. And he came home, and he found a sign in the yard saying, "Welcome home, Dad." And he came in. And kids were getting ready for school, and the wife was getting ready for work. And he said, "You know, how did you know that I was coming home today?" And they said, "We knew you would try to surprise us. So we just put the sign up right away when the war was over, knowing that someday you'd be coming home." I thought that was a great story that tied into this. Don't you guys think that was a great story? Yeah, okay. All right. Yeah, there you go. But anyways, Jesus will come at an unexpected time. Now check out this verse that Jesus said in Matthew 24. "But concerning that day and hour, no one knows. Not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son." Now, what is Jesus saying here? Jesus is saying that the angels don't know. And Jesus is saying that I don't know, but the Father only. "For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man." Just regular life will be happening. 1 Thessalonians. Because what happened in the early church is they were concerned, like, wait, did we miss the second coming? And so 1 Thessalonians on the second coming, 2 Thessalonians, a major theme. You see in almost all of the rest of the New Testament, some mention instruction on the second coming. 1 Thessalonians 5. "Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourself are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." When does a thief come? He comes when it's unexpected that you would catch him. While people are saying There is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. And so as we wrap this up, and before Helen comes up here for communion, the parable of the 10 virgins, three things to think about is that God's resources are for everybody. And how do people get God's resources? Is people like you and me are the distributor of salvation and Jesus. Being spiritually skilled is a lifesaver. How do we see Jesus deciding who goes into heaven and who doesn't? Is the ones that are prepared. And Jesus is very clear, just like the rest of Scripture, is that the second coming will come at an unexpected time. Now you know, all of us know, and we're accountable for what we know. Let me go ahead and pray, and Helen's going to come up here and lead us in communion. Lord, I just thank you. Thank you for the group here. Thank you for all that you're doing here at Hope, that you're alive. Pray for protection at camp. Pray that kids would not only just hear about you, but there would be a penetration of you in their hearts, that they would open their hearts to you. Pray that's what happened here, second service and online here at Hope Community, that our hearts are open and that you're moving in our hearts. Thank you for all your goodness. Thank you for all your gifts. Thank you for you being in our life. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on up, Helen.
Good morning, Hope family. It's so wonderful to be here. I've kind of had a rough few weeks. For those of you that know that my husband has had back pain for the last year, and he had surgery. And so it's been difficult to just watch someone you love be debilitated by back pain, and just spiritually it's been a challenging time. So I think that Bill's message was very on point, because you do have to have those spiritual skills to lean on in times of chaos and in times that you aren't prepared for. You know, even as much as we are in the Bible or praying for others or showing our love, you can never be prepared for things that happen. And chaos reveals our strength, and it also reveals other people's strength. You know, I'm really thankful for my neighbor who just said, "I'm cooking you dinner tonight. I'm bringing it over." He didn't ask me, "Let me know if I can do anything for you," or, you know, I feel bad for you. He actually showed his love, and I'm very thankful for that. And what really stuck with me is, even though some people are not who you want them to be and cannot be strong for you in times that you need their strength, Jesus is there to be strong for me. And I could rely on him to really see me through this time. So as we take communion, let us be reminded that Jesus was on the cross for us. He's still there. He is alive. And we can feel his strength when we praise him, when we're in church, and when we show our love to others. That's what he wanted us to do. So let's take this bread, this cracker, and be reminded of Jesus' body, which he gave up willingly for us. And as we take the juice, let's be reminded that his blood was shed for us. And let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for being with us always, and for letting your love show through others. And let us this week be your hands and feet, as you asked us to do, to show our love to others in words, deeds, and most of all, actions. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you. Yourself there. Have a blessed weekend, buddy.